I exchanged my call sign with someone in Slovakia. If the conditions are just right, and that depends on weather and sunspot activity and stuff, you can really sort of get your RF out across the world. 2 meter band is generally considered to be sort of much closer range.
Are we looking at the post-apocalyptic internet here?
I think so, yeah.
So after civilization falls apart,
I'll be talking to Dave over making sure everything's okay. It seemed to die briefly. I'm scared to touch anything because it will suddenly die.
So this is quite flaky stuff, right?
Mainly, it's normally very reliable. The problem is that we have these cables, which I made myself, and don't look at this one.
Why have we got two ThinkPads sitting on a desk in front of us?
They're going to sleep. Well, I thought it might be interesting to talk a little bit about packet radio and maybe touch on amateur radio in general as well. Packet radio is essentially sending data over the radio waves, and the frequency spectrum, part of the frequency spectrum that I'm using at the moment is the amateur radio band. So this is 2 meter band, what I'm using now, and that's about 144-145 megahertz. 2 meter band is probably the band with the most packet radio because of something called APRS, which is the automatic packet reporting system. That's all based upon one protocol called AX25. And this is kind of it's X25, but modified to accommodate some of the things required to make it work on amateur radio instead of over some kind of cable. Okay, so we've got two of the cheapest ham radios. These are Baofeng UV5Rs. We've got two laptops, and we've got two what are essentially modems. They're called terminal node controllers, and they essentially take data through a serial input and turn it into some sort of strange sound, a bit like dial-up. Essentially, we're encapsulating what we would normally put on Ethernet, but we're encapsulating in what's called KISS framing. And on top of that, AX25. I think I should probably draw this out because it's getting a bit complicated. Let's draw a radio. And then we have our modems or terminal node controllers. And these are talking to the radio. This is actually an audio cable. So this is just audio going straight into the radio. And then we have two computers. This is my laptop. And this is a serial cable. I will draw the frame, so the TCP/IP. So at the very bottom, we have KISS, which stands for Keep It Simple Stupid. And the way this type of framing works is that if you send a zero, that means there's a data frame coming in, so it's very simple. After that, we have sort of AX25, and this essentially talks at hardware addresses, so what you might typically consider to be MAC addresses, but in the case of radio, it's actually my call sign, which is M6PIU.
And there you go. If you need to get in touch with Alan,
get on the radio.
Urgently.
Yeah. And then, so this AX25 actually becomes the lowest layer in the setup that I've got here of the TCP/IP stack. So this is sort of, let's say, M6PIU to my friend G1ZEK. This guy actually gave me this TNC here. So this is sort of very low level framing of messages. It's just saying, pass this data over to this, and this is the length of the data. So this entire thing is going to be the TCP/IP stack with this framing underneath it. On top of that, we have the internet layer. So this internet layer works on the basis of IP addresses. So ham radio operators are fortunate enough to be allocated 44.0.0.0/8. So that's a huge range of IP addresses. And you can, as a ham radio operator, be allocated a small portion of that. So this is the kind of level that the internet protocol layer runs at. So actual IP addresses rather than Ethernet addresses or call signs, as in the case of X25. If you look in ARP.c in the Linux kernel, you'll see specific references to AX25 for the way that it formats call signs as if they were Ethernet addresses, MAC addresses. So on top of the internet layer, we have the transport layer. So this is TCP. So this is TCP over IP. Let's just call it TCP. It could also be UDP. And on top of this, we have the application. Maybe we can talk about what's actually being transmitted right now. Every 5 seconds, we're sending a ping. It's at the same level of TCP UDP, so we could also write ping here. And you'd also have, for example, ARP here. So this is the address resolution protocol. So it's converting internet addresses into Ethernet or call signs. When I want to send a ping to this machine, essentially what's happening is my computer first uses ARP to resolve the call sign for the IP address. So it says, who is 44.131.56.17? Tell, and then the address that it's coming from. So in this case, 44.131.56.16. So 17, if it's available, will respond to this packet and say that 44.131.56.17 is at m6piu-some SSID. So in the case, I think one of these is 0 and the other one is 1.
Well, is that different devices?
Yeah, because the call sign is being used as the kind of Ethernet address in the typical sense. You can't have the same address in two places, especially if you were to use more than two machines, because they would both respond, they would both end up receiving a packet destined to a certain IP address. So once you know the call sign or the Ethernet address, the packets can be actually sent via AX25, because that's the only level above AX25. It doesn't understand anything past that. It's just call signs and sort of packet length. This information is going to be cached for a while. I forget how long exactly, maybe 5 or 10 minutes, or until it fails to contact the remote host again.
I've got a vision of the airways being filled with lots of this happening from lots of devices, but on the same channel. Is that how it works?
So lots of devices can use the same frequency with AX25 because the packets are being sent with a sender and a recipient in each packet.
Do you get clashes though?
You do. Actually, one of the biggest problems with running modern day Linux on over ham radio is that it's expecting the network hardware to respond very quickly. So when it does this step, it says, who has this address, tell whoever. It has already requested the same information again before it's even gone out of the modem. So you have to kind of set this to a more reasonable time, like 5 seconds or something instead of 100. If you're continuously requesting the same information, the recipient has no time to respond because this is only half duplex. Only one person on the radio wave or the frequency can speak at a time. This one is actually pinging right now. I've set the interval to 5 seconds and it takes about 2.6 seconds for a ping to reach its destination and be replied to. What we have here is machine 0 pinging machine 1. So this is from no ARP information cached at all yet. So the first packet that we received is coming from M6PIU with some SSID, going to QST. And QST is kind of US Q code speak for all operators that are listening. So we're saying to everyone that's listening, tell me who has this address, 41.131.56.17. This gets sent a couple of times, and eventually machine 1 responds to machine 0, so it's coming again from me to me, and it's saying that machine 1 address is 44.131.56.17, and it's at this sort of Ethernet address, or hardware address. This hardware address is actually my call sign encoded in some strange way with some bit shifting, just to kind of make the character set fit into what would typically be a hardware address. So this happens a few times because not all packets are sent successfully. Sometimes it's quite impatient and will send the same packet again, especially in the beginning. But once machine 0 has learned that the hardware address, my call sign, is associated with the IP address of machine 1, it can start sending ping requests. So these purple packets are ICMP, which is the pinging protocol. Here we have two ping requests and then two responses. So these are going at a higher layer now in the TCP IP stack. They're using IP addresses as opposed to hardware addresses. So what we ended up with is sort of a ping response time of about 2.5 seconds, which is not bad considering we're running at probably around 1.2 kilobits per second.
This is a kind of closed demo with two machines and two radios.
Mm-hmm.
Is anyone else out there?
So I quite frequently talk to my friend G1ZEK over AX25, not via TCP, but at a lower level. So if you don't connect up the stuff, or if you don't activate the TCP layers above this, you can connect to these just via a serial terminal, such as GNU Screen, and you can exchange messages just as text. It's much more reliable than trying to get TCP IP working on top of it.
So because you've got all these layers working in the TCP IP, what does that give us that you wouldn't get another way? Would you be able to, say, send a website or something?
We can definitely send a website. I can show you that. It will take quite a while to load. It'll be a very small website. Let's set up a small web server and try to load that page. One of the problems is that so really, operating two radios in such close proximity is a terrible idea. You can actually damage them. I've got these set to 1 watt, and I've tried to put as much space between them as I can. The problem is that with these very cheap USB to serial adapters, they kind of crash if there's too much RF around. So a lot of the time, I have to keep on restarting this because it breaks, basically. So let's try and load a page.
So the flashing there is connection, it's little packets being sent.
Yeah, so on this side it says XMIT for transmit and receive. You can see that when transmit is red here, receive is red over on this side, so they should be alternating. Ping actually takes up a significant amount of bandwidth when you're at this speed, so I'll kill ping, it seems to be working. So I've got a web browser open, I prepared a little page earlier. It's only one sentence, but...
What are we looking at for a sentence? A minute? Several minutes?
It depends on how reliable it is, because it could take hours at this rate. But a single sentence, I don't know, maybe... If you have everything tuned quite precisely, maybe 20 seconds or something.
Shall I ask a silly question? Pictures?
I have done it. It took maybe 10 minutes, so... But a picture of me has... Been, well, probably it's out of space now, you know.
Yeah. Transmitting.
A very weak signal of my face. So this machine on the left received a packet saying, who is this address? Tell that one, but it doesn't seem to have responded. So these connectors are also very flaky, so let's give them a squeeze. Come on, you can do it. From the activity light here, it looks like pings are being sent and there are responses coming through. But currently it says that destination host is unreachable. What you can do instead of using these things is actually use the sound card. And that's sort of become more popular now. I quite like these because...
Well, you can see a lot of information at the
point, I suppose. I think they're much more cool than using a sound card. It's timed out, what a surprise.
Is Wireshark showing all the data coming across?
It's showing the packets being exchanged, yeah. So they're definitely talking to each other right now. There's a lot of packets which are becoming out of order or being retransmitted, yeah. I think it has timed out again. Let's try using curl. Curl is just a simple command line utility to request web pages and files from web servers. The Python web server here picked up that I requested a page.
Okay, that's the first start, right?
Yeah, it hasn't. Ah, the page is loaded, but only in curl. I don't want to show you. No, I will. It's just down here. So this is the HTML that I typed in, which is this Hello Computer file from M6PIU. So we're going to try and load it in a web browser now.
It's all your CSS, right?
Oh, yeah, for this website. And on my personal one, it's loaded with CSS. Should have timed it, shouldn't we? Let's, just to be sure, open it in a new tab.
A lot of recent commands from scratch.
Yeah, so I just saw on this little Python web server that the page was requested. You see, I also got it working this morning and it was fine. So these are our... Aha! It's done! There you go. Hello, computer file. I spelled it right, I think. I think in the early days, it probably contributed somewhat to research towards TCP/IP and other network protocols, especially on slow connections, unreliable connections. Like this. And I like to think of it as the grandfather of like GPRS and Wi-Fi and everything that works now.
you would have two S-boxes here, two 4-bit S-boxes, for example, plugging into one 8-bit permutation box. So the outputs of these get jumbled about and mixed up here. The way an SP network works is it repeats.
It would look a lot more random. You'd have sort of clusters of things. Actually, these numbers were chosen 3/16, 5/16, 1/16, 7/16.